And as I was feeling in today's transmission and download of teachings, what I wanted to offer was an answer to a very common question that came up as a result of the last video that was put out. In the last video, I spoke about the fact that all of us are light workers. In our everyday lives, whether we are formally working as light workers as a full-time or part-time profession. That a lot of us don't realize that what we're feeling and thinking on an everyday basis is what we are clearing out of the collective consciousness for all. And that what you've already been doing your entire life is helping to transmute out of the collective so that all can begin to remember and embody their true nature in an accelerated way. And that once you become aware that you are already a light worker, and the very fact that what you think and feel is what's being cleared out of your field, some had a very obvious question about that and a concern. And the concern was, that's great that what I feel and I'm thinking that I find to be the most disturbing, uncomfortable, and inconvenient is what I'm clearing for the totality. That's wonderful. However, does this mean that I'm going to have to be clearing it for all forever? Right? On one hand, yay, I'm doing so much for the world just by being as I am. That's wonderful. In the next breath, when does it stop? I'm willing to clear for the well-being of all for a certain amount of time. And it's logical and it makes a lot of sense, because wouldn't it make sense to say, well, if you're clearing for the totality, there has to eventually be a time when the totality is clear, wouldn't you say? And I'm not going to suggest that, yes, we're clearing for the totality and we're just going to go on forever thinking and feeling outrageously limiting things and just saying, hooray, look what we're doing for the world. I'm going to suggest that there's even the next level of revelation in the teachings that I like to provide, unfold, and transmit one step at a time. So the fact that so many had the question of like, okay, well then what's next? I'm transmuting for all, yay, all. Now what? Tells us that we are already ripe and ready for the next revelation. Because while it is true, just in your ability to feel and comprehend what you're thinking and feeling is letting you know what's being lifted out of the field of yourself and of all. Until you know that, you don't experience the rewarding space that your entire lifetime or lifetimes have created for all. Once you become aware that you're doing your very deep soul work just by being this incarnated individual expression, you begin to feel some relief and openness from your lifetimes of clearing work. But there has to be a shift from being in an endless vortex of clearing into a brand new paradigm of anchoring. It's almost like there's two different paradigms. There's a paradigm of clearing, where what's coming up to be faced is being cleared and released out of your field at the rate at which you experience it. And even if you resist what you're feeling and thinking, that just means that you're experiencing the release of resistance out of your field. So there's no wrong in that clearing paradigm. But then there's this anchoring paradigm where you've cleared enough space, and now you're not clearing anymore. You're just anchoring the higher vibrational realities and energies so that the world can start to feel in itself what you are bringing forth to the world. And the confusion is that there are many modalities that teach the clearing paradigm. There are many who speak of the anchoring paradigm, and one does not lead to the other. So today I want to speak about how to shift from being the endless agent of clearing the world's crap, how to retire from being the cosmic garbage man, and to being a living anchor of your highest destiny. You know, real light material. And because, as I sit before you in my own personal journey, I spent my entire life clearing for the well-being of all, being a very deeply aware empath, having to go through a life of refinement so my empathic abilities didn't bring so much undue harm onto me. For the first half of my life as an empath, I was very much traumatized by my abilities because I was feeling what everyone else was feeling, didn't know that that was what they were feeling, thinking it was what they thought of me. So I spent most of my life trying to cheer people up, thinking when I feel their happiness, that means they like me. That's a pattern or a stage I like to call energetic codependency. We can't be okay in ourselves until other people are balanced in their energy fields. And we become these very crafty counselors and healers on the playgrounds of life, trying to get people to cheer up so that we can feel normal. And it's a very serious thing because we're all going through something that most of the world hasn't acknowledged exists yet. And then you talk to people about it and it gets put into all these different categories that isn't actually what it is. It's very mysterious. And then, of course, when you're talking about things that no one else is really understanding, it makes you think maybe it's me. And it really is that we are very much pioneers in the first wave of ascension, coming into the full embodiment and vibrational prominence of our highest self, bringing it forward into a world so that the world can start to recognize and taste and savor the ecstasy of its own eternal light. It's kind of that whole being ahead of your time thing. Kind of stinks. It's a good sales pitch, though, right? You're in heaven. You're going to go and you're going to be ahead of your time. Really? Ahead of my time? A pioneer? Yes. And then you get to be a pioneer, which means you come into a world where no one understands anything you're experiencing. And it feels weird. And you either think, well, I'm just having experienced no one else's, and it can develop this weird form of spiritual arrogance. Or most likely it creates this insecurity of, maybe I'm just insane. Because my intuitive experiences aren't matching the insanity of everyone else. And as I went down that road, here I sit before you as someone who cleared all that energy for the well-being of all, like we all are doing. And here I sit before you as someone who went through the successful transition into being a fully embodied anchor of higher consciousness, where I walk around the world and I actually don't feel the chaos or heaviness of what's unresolved in people anymore. I am just communing in the oneness of the highest self in all that is reflecting back to me what is embodying this body. And I can feel what's going on, but it's no longer what it used to be. It used to be like I'd walk into a grocery store and like nearly topple over from the energy of what's unresolved in people. And then again, in my younger years, I would misunderstand what's going on in them as what they thought about me. I mean, it'd be like at a grocery store and someone's at the deli going, can I help you? Yeah, I'd like to ask, why do you hate me? Hi, why do you hate me? I'm feeling this craziness in your heart, and I'm thinking it's about me. And they don't even know what's going on in their body yet, so they have no idea what I'm talking about. Wild. It's wild when you can know more of what's going on in someone else's body than they do. Wild. So I'd like to share with you my personal journey today. I'd like to share with you something I've never actually publicly talked about. And it's not like I've had this information about my journey and thought, oh, I'm not ready to share that revelation. I don't remember anything about my life, ever. I only recall and remember what is downloaded to me as the next thing I'm going to share. In fact, even memories of my life when I'm sharing them, I only remember the exact memories at the moment I meant to share them as a teaching. But as I walk around, I really have no memory of anything. So it's not like I've known I'm about to tell you, I'm like, well, he didn't feel we were ready for that. I wasn't told to remember what I'm going to tell you until this morning. And I went, oh yeah, that did happen. Wow. So I'm going to tell you what I forgot happened, that I have been reminded to tell you at the most appropriate time in history. And it answers the question, how do you go from being an anchor and clearing the endless crap of people's unconsciousness into an anchor of the higher vibrational realms, right? To give you a bridge from one to the other, we have to explore what I call the highest vibration. Ooh. I remember being a little kid and exploring spirituality and just looking at different things. And anytime that there was an idea of like levels of consciousness or highest, even as a kid, it was so funny. I would always think, oh, there are stages of consciousness. I'll start at the top. What's the top? I'll take that. Thank you. Oh, what's the highest vibration? I'll take that. Well, it's going to cause me to totally evaporate like I'm walking into the sun. That's okay. Whatever the highest is, that's what I want. I'm not going to start at stage one, two. We're going to go to stage kabillion, right off the bat. That's how you know when a soul is really in it for a really intense journey, right? Talk to the angels. Hey, I'm ready for my journey. Oh, really? What stage do you think you should start at? I was thinking stage kabillion. Let's start there. Oh. But let's first define the highest vibration. Because if you understand the highest vibration, and I'm not going to define it in the typical way, because when we have this conversation about the highest vibration, some people say joy is the highest vibration, love is the highest vibration, ecstasy, bliss, right? We always try to find the next word to outdo it. Ecstasy, bliss, transcendence. Unattached transcendence. Super transcendence. Super duper transcendence. And we're always trying to get to the next bigger word. And we're actually having a conversation about vibrational frequency in a very linear way. But that's not actually how we understand the highest vibration. The highest vibration is actually a word called celebration. And it's out of celebration that joy, benevolence, oneness, ecstasy, bliss, love, salvation, transcendence arise. So it's not like joy is better than grace, is better than ecstasy or bliss. It's that all of these are various frequencies that emanate out of the highest vibration called celebration. Does that make sense? So celebration is the highest vibration, and those that follow specific models of labeled, you know, levels of consciousness will wag their finger at me, and I'm fully prepared for that. But I just want to explain it in a more practical way, not disagreeing with anyone, but the scales of joy, bliss, ecstasy, love, transcendence, it all is under the umbrella of celebration. And here's why I say this to you. Men, and again, it doesn't matter if you're not on a spiritual path, you're on a spiritual path, you've been on a spiritual path for 1,000 years, 1,000 lifetimes. What the misunderstanding is once I feel joy, happiness, peace, love, or once I have a life where the things I believe will bring me joy, peace, and love are present in my reality, then I'm going to celebrate. But until those things show up, until I feel that way, I'm not going to celebrate. Does that sound familiar? Right? We look around at life and these intolerable, insufferable circumstances, and we think, who could celebrate during a time like this? And we're saying, we're going to use spirituality to fix all the problems. And once we have cleared all the stuff out, then we're going to celebrate. And we're not going to celebrate until we feel good, because that's not when it's appropriate to start. And until we feel that way, we're going to frown at each other. And pretend nothing other than what we want matters. Truth be told, no matter how many times you've been around a spiritual journey, no matter how many times you've been disappointed, experienced loss, learned from the impermanence of life, things, not even spiritual attainments, make you joyful, happy, peaceful, free, all these things, to give you the permission to celebrate. And in fact, the teaching is turning that mentality upside down and saying, only when I start to celebrate, whatever is present in my reality, will the joy, peace, love, bliss, and ecstasy come alive within me. Does that make sense? So we all wait for things to change before we say, I'm ready to celebrate. And until we celebrate, those things don't come alive. It's like the ultimate spiritual standoff. And life has all the time in the world. And we go, okay, I've been waiting for the career change. That's not happening. Or I've gone through many career change. That doesn't seem to work. Relationships, went through them like tissue paper. I've moved to nearly every continent in the world. I got nowhere else to go. I've lived at every vortex on the planet. I've studied every modality. Done every practice. Eventually what dawns on you is, maybe I'm supposed to celebrate first and then everything comes to me. Maybe. Because the other way doesn't work. And I'm saying this to you because I'm going to share with you, like I said, my journey. How did I go from being an empathic clearing agent of the unconsciousness to an anchor of the higher vibrational energies for the well-being of all? And I did it by understanding the highest vibration of celebration. And what I realized is that what was taught to me by a society, and I don't blame society or families or anyone's, you know, because it's all a big setup. This is a play. So, of course, I learned the way life really doesn't work so that I can realize the way life works on a deeper level and experience transformation. And it seems in the world that I was raised in, there was a belief that you don't celebrate what doesn't feel good. You fight what doesn't feel good until it feels the way you want it to feel, and then you cheer your dominance. Right? That's what I was taught how to do. I mean, I wasn't on a societal level. Raised in a very wonderful, beautifully family. But as I would watch the world, this is what I was learning. When things don't go your way, raise hell. Until people can't tolerate your hell and they give in. That might work. Let's try that. kids try to test it all the time. My tantrum's not working? What if I get louder? Let's see. Oh, they're grimacing. They're crumbling. It's working. They're going to give me a cookie just to shut up. Now I know how to get a cookie. And as I grew up, just in my observations of the world, none of that mentality started to make any sense. And I started to, on a very deep spiritual level, as I went through my awakenings and realizations, I started to touch into a celebration that would embrace and adore everything, no matter my experience of it. And so the question I asked myself, on what ground would I celebrate something that feels inconvenient and uncomfortable to me? Right? I mean, that's a good question. Like, on what basis? Like, someone could say to you, hey, celebrate it. Oh, that's pissing you off? That makes you want to hurt something? Makes you want to punch a wall? You should celebrate that. Like, on what basis would you celebrate something that makes you want to act ridiculously? I mean, logically speaking, when you're about to flip out, that's probably not the time that you're celebrating something. So I would ask, on what basis? Because it started to feel crazy to me. And I started to realize the things that felt crazy were actually the things that made the most sense to me. I would soon learn, whatever was the crazy direction is where I need to go. So on what basis would I celebrate the things that don't feel good to me? Life doesn't go my way, throw a party. Why would I do that? And I spontaneously had a realization that I was born into a world going through a human condition where I would go through all spectrums of experience. I was transmuting out of the collective what I was thinking and feeling just by feeling deeper than what most people were willing to acknowledge. And all of these things that I was taught about, feelings, thoughts, beliefs, cause, effect, action, reaction, were all in the absence of acknowledging that each and everything was an expression of divinity. And that I only had a consciousness that could perceive what I like in comparison to what I don't like, frustrated when I'm on this end, elated when I'm on this end, then sad when I go back over here. All of that was a play in the absence of recognizing every single thing as an expression of divinity. And as I started to touch into that realization, then I had this weird thought that, and this thought for a little bit in a very early stage of my journey tripped me up a little bit. And it was, oh, this is all divinity. And then I started coming up with all these, you know, atrocious examples, even murder. And then I would go, oh, I don't know. I don't know. And then all of a sudden, accepting everything as divine will stopped. And back into the play I went. Because I couldn't justify, I couldn't explain why everything was divine will. And so I went back into the belief that not everything is divine will. There's something other than God existing. And I use the word divine because it's a safer word. Sometimes God has that kind of connotation. For me, God is the greatest word in the world. But sometimes people have associations, so I use divinity just to make it universal. And eventually something radical happened in me. Again, radical. Today is about what radical thing happened to me that just in speaking about it, I'm transmitting this radical nature to you so that you can get to the revolutionary part of the love revolution. Because I will tell you something radical happened to me. And the radical thing that happened to me is I started to get back into everything is divine will. And I'm only experiencing the unfulfillment, the inconvenience, the pain, the treachery, the turmoil, the injustice of human behavior. because I'm perceiving a world where I am not fully on board with only divinity is here. And I'm trying to justify divinity with rational beliefs of reason, of good and bad, through linear perception. And I started to get into this radical declaration, I declare only the divine is here. And then the thought came back, what about suffering and murder? And then I said to myself, that thought isn't to be answered, but only honored as divine perfection as well. And I didn't even touch the question. I didn't step forward to try to answer the question because I was too busy honoring it as divine will. It is the will of the divine to consider a question that can't be answered, but only honored in a state of celebration. And from this space, something radical happened to me. From this space, I no longer had problems with my thoughts because thoughts would only arise to show me the experiences of what things could be like having lived a life in the absence of realizing it as a creation of divinity. And a thought would arise and I would say, yet another expression of divine perfection. And all of a sudden, it didn't matter what I thought about it. It didn't matter what I felt about it. It didn't matter whether it was inconvenient, congruent to my spiritual beliefs. It didn't matter if it hurt or felt good. It was only arising to give me a chance to free myself of these deep-rooted beliefs that leaves a door open for something other than the divine to exist. And I incarnated to close that door. Only the divine is here. So help me, God. Any thought that wants to arise in this mind will only be glorified and honored as the highest expression of divine perfection, no matter what it looks like, sounds like, or feels like until the end of time. And that was the moment thoughts disappeared. Then feelings would erupt in my body. Inconvenience, fear, anxiety. The next stage in the unreasonable, radically direct path of spirituality. This is divine perfection, unleashing its divine perfection and will within me. And I did what a lot of people think is counterintuitive, but it's the most sensible thing you'll ever do, which is to celebrate everything you feel. Yes. Yes, this sadness is nothing but divine will. And Lord, if you want to manifest as sadness, you just crank up the heat and show me how sad I can be. Yes. And then sadness had no game to play with me. What more could sadness teach someone who's only willing to glorify the divine within it, no matter how hard it cranks up? All judgments had been dissipated. Sadness had nothing more to teach me. That disappeared. Fear would arise. Yes, Lord. Show me your fury and your absolute power. Show me how afraid one can be and show me your power at full capacity and I will glorify your eternal name. And if this is the energy that's going to take me down, then I will leave this planet rejoicing you who has brought me here. And that disappeared. Then frustration would arise. Frustration not based on the actions of other people, but just an energy that dared to arise in my body that would even try to come close to taking my attention away from the light, purity, and grace of God. Nice try. Go for it. You want me to pretend to react to someone in a store and get agitated? Then agitate the living shit out of me. I'm here to glorify divinity, and I'm here to bring heaven to life. So you want to bring agitation and frustration? You bring to me what the world has pretended as something other than God, and I'll do nothing but rejoice in the God that everyone forgot. Go for it. And it disappeared. And I started to realize the most radical path. Every single thing is arising for you to celebrate, but you have to realize that you're celebrating that whatever is expressing itself on the infinite spectrum of experience, from good to bad in a judgment or high to low in a vibrational assessment, is only one of infinite expressions of the divine. And we are here not to reason through reality, but to, in the greatest demonstration of faith, just remind ourselves that the one eternal source of all that is your true nature could only be what's lurking in the shadows of all your experiences. And instead of being a connoisseur of your experiences, where you're able to speak about the highs and lows by comparison, you simply surrender the need to decide what you personally think about anything and just celebrate the divine in all that arises. And that's when salvation comes for you. And even when you have these feelings of, I don't like this, that could only be divine perfection as well. Oh, well, I wish I felt this way instead. And yet another creation of divinity. Do you see? If you were to poll the majority of the world and ask the world, what is the problem or barrier that's in the way of your celebration? They would write down all these different things. Problems with past, problem with job, with relationship, with money, all these things. 99% of the time, if you looked at what people would write out as what the problem is, what you would not see is God's name. And that's why problems exist. So you bring the word of God or divine will into your living celebration, and you simply look at your life as a spiritual adventure where you are facing all the things that you've been taught to judge as other than the divine, and bring forth a celebration that it is only the divine, and no matter how it acts, you're not going to be convinced that it's less than the divine than anything else, and the game will be done in you, and you'll no longer be a spiritual garbage man, and you will become an anchor of the highest vibration in existence, which is the energy of celebration. And this radical, revolutionary awakening woke up in me so deeply, and even beyond the self-realization, the disappearance of the personal will, the sense of myself as a person disappearing, seeing myself in a mirror just vanish. All these different stages of awakening and throughout the various realms of enlightenment. Even though I realized myself to be the all that is, I was still in this reality years ago where I was living as the all that is, still being thrown around by the human condition. Right? I'm the all that is being toppled by all this crap still. What? That's like being the ocean that's drowned by waves. I was the ocean that still didn't know how to swim. And I realized all of these things were coming to me because I was there to undo all the judgments and just honor the divinity in everything that arose in my life. And that's when everything came full circle. That's when what had awakened within all the starting started to be the energy throughout, and my inner and outer started to merge. And that's when I wasn't just a spiritual being thrown around by the collective unconscious turmoil, but became a fully embodied anchor that is here to transform the world for the well-being of all. Simply because I brought with me the recognition of what everything was, no matter what I saw. I didn't stop to explain to myself or ask myself, well, how is this divine perfection? I don't ask that. I just declare it. Even to such a radical depth And I'm not suggesting that you have to do what I don't suggest that you have to do it as radically as I did, because that's just the nature of my journey. But I will tell you that I took this journey so radically so that I can be the type of transmission that transmits the energy to you and provides you with the clarity and gifts that my path provided for how deeply I decided to go. Because I found myself at a stage in my journey more courageous than I've ever been in my entire life, telling the universe, no mercy for me. You give all your mercy to people that forget your holy name. No mercy for me, for I will not ask for you to water down your glory. I want to know all that is about the divine that I am. And if that needs to erupt within as feelings and thoughts and experiences that will rip me apart, then tear down this prison and show me the way. No mercy for this one ever again. Because any time I found myself begging for mercy, I was not remembering the God within me, and I was certainly not accepting the divinity within the experience that was only freeing me of my own self-imprisonment. Even on my spiritual journey, as I started to teach and expand and do what I do, and people would say, maybe you should ask the universe to slow it down with you. And I would smile and say, I don't water down the divine. And I became fully realized in the truth that everything is divine perfection. And I welcomed the will of the divine in every breath. I wasn't looking for pain. I wasn't looking for dissatisfaction. I was no longer willing to have a defense strategy as if I was under the impression that there's something other than divinity at work in every moment. And when I did that, life backed off immediately. Perhaps the only reason why we are in such turmoil is that life is trying to rip apart out of our realities a belief that there's something other than divinity at play that causes us to circumstantially trust or only have faith when things seem to go our way. Oh, things are going my way. I'm going to have faith now. We're not here to be cowards anymore. We've already done that. We've already incarnated and had faith when things are going our way. Oh, everything's going my way. I have faith today. Yay, God is great. And then the next day happens. Is God still great? And it's not a God looking down on you. It is your highest self putting you in a position to wake up out of these limiting beliefs. And for you to come to an unreasonable level of truth that says when life goes your way, you celebrate the divine's name in whatever way you wish. And when life isn't going your way, you celebrate louder. You cheer louder. When it's time to cry, you cry like you never cried before. When it's time to laugh, you laugh like you're about to have a heart attack. When you celebrate as deep as you can till it almost feels a little unreasonable. And you do it all in the name of the divinity that you are. And there becomes no moment in life where you are ever void of celebration. And in that moment, you're making that one shift that's necessary. And the shift says, I don't wait for things to work a certain way before I celebrate. I celebrate existence. And however I'm meant to exist is the will of the divine. And I am that divine will that is here to celebrate the glory of the highest perspective that only knows that I don't know why I'm feeling this way or going through this, but it could only be to ensure my highest growth and evolution. And I don't need to know where that evolution is going. I only need to trust that it is the highest love and consciousness at play, guaranteeing that highest destiny within me that I bring forward by declaring that only the will of the divine is here orchestrating and enduring this. That's what it takes. And all of our spiritual understanding, even the understanding about self-realization, even the idea that there's no individual self here, gets thrown out the window. Because even those that want to make those nice, clear distinctions, which are wonderful, because there are very deep realizations when we have them, but those aren't what we hold on to. Because even that becomes the new thing you talk about instead of the divine. Oh, there's no real individual self, and you could see from a perspective that life is one grand illusion. We're still not talking about divinity. Until we talk about divinity, none of this is going to relent. The minute you start talking about divinity, the heaven that's already here is revealed and the hell that never was vanishes. That's what this is all about. That's the entry point into Christhood. And surprisingly, no matter where you think you are, where you're not in the journey, the door is always open. You don't need any kind of, you don't have to earn any credits in order to earn your right. It's not like a school. You know, I don't have enough credits for Christhood yet. Gonna go mop up more of the world's crap. Maybe next summer I'll be in Christhood. You enter that school of divinity, you enter the door of Christhood through your unreasonable declaration that only the divine is here. And it's not a divine that you're not, it's a divine that you are. But you have to affirm that the divine that you are is what's working through you and orchestrating all of this so that the divine that you are can work through you to do it all for you. Now, if you're overly analytical, that's not going to make any sense. It's going to sound like some sort of personality disorder. First he was in first person point of view, then he was in third, and This isn't about logic. This is about life. Life isn't logical. You ever noticed? Life isn't logical, and the more logical you try to make it, the more freaked out you get. Because life isn't trying to be logical. Life's enjoying itself. And not in a logical way. As if we're all going to go into the kingdom of heaven, be in the presence of our own divinity, talk to God and go, well, that's reasonable. I get it now. Thanks for telling me all this. Now I understand. I have a full understanding. Thank you very much. Oh, you're even going to give me a brochure to take away? Thank you. With all the bullet points so I don't forget? That's very reasonable. Thank you. Wow. Okay. Is that the way things are supposed to happen? No, what's going to happen is that you're going to go to heaven, which you're already in heaven, but you're going to go to a different realm of heaven. You're going to come face to face with your own divinity, and you're going to be in the presence of God, which is just an externalized manifestation of your own light, your own unobstructed light just reflected back to you. And you're going to interact with it like, I'm a soul talking to the Heavenly Father. And you're going to sit there and say, oh my God, I'm so sorry for all the things I did. I don't know what I was sent down there to do, but I racked up quite a bar tab. I don't know what I was supposed to do. I did a lot of stuff when I was down there. I mean, I got there on a spiritual mission, but a lot of pretty ladies, a lot of delicious food. I mean, I'm sorry. And you sit there and apologize to the light of God. And God, in its brilliance, says to you, why would you apologize for anything you've ever done when it was only I working through you as I am? As of today, what if you didn't apologize for anything and just accepted it's the will of God? See, and then the fearful egoic mind goes, but if I do that and not look at myself, I might just let go and do something really crazy. But that's only how we act if we don't let go. And it's not let go like you're personally letting go of something. Letting go like that, people teach that, or people interpret the teaching like that, like, I'm just going to let it go. That's reverse control. Control is, I need that. Let it go is, I'm in charge of letting it go. Now, how are you going to let something go and be in charge of it at the same time? That's why it doesn't work. Let it go is let go of anything other than, or letting go of the belief that there's anything other than divinity at play. That's what real letting go means. So just embrace the fact that it's only the divine doing all of this. And you are the divine, but you've got to give it all to the divine that you are so that divinity shines through you. And so that brings us to the spiritual path of celebration. And what the radical pointer or teaching is about celebration is instead of getting caught in spiritual victimhood, which is I'm using all my spiritual teachings, I'm all my modalities, all my 10 steps to this and 5 steps to that, and I'm trying to change the furniture of my reality. Maybe I'm not changing my partner, changing my job, but I'm trying to do all my spiritual voodoo to secretly change the way they act towards me. And let's talk about the teaching of celebration. The teaching of celebration says you don't change most of the time. You don't change anything about your reality. And I say that with respect to if you're working somewhere where the conditions are intolerable, if you're in a relationship that really isn't honoring your well-being, the divinity within you always has a choice to move you somewhere that respects your well-being. But usually, we're not in celebration, we're not using spirituality to try to change our experience. We're actually using celebration to change the way we honor our experience. So think of how radical it is, where instead of trying to, you know, wake up each day and thinking, today I'm going to be a deeper embodiment of my highest wisdom, and then you're going to totally not do it, and then blame yourself, and then spend your spiritual life just berating and bullying yourself and being mad that you wake up and can't do the things you want to do. You wake up, I'm going to be love in action. And someone triggers you. You say something you didn't mean. And you go, I can't do it right. Says the God that refuses to admit only God is here. So what if in the radical path of celebration, instead, you just celebrated however you behave? Because the reason you're behaving in a way that looks contrary to your highest wisdom is because you have not spent enough time, and I don't mean you have to spend like the rest of your life, but you have not spent a consistent amount of time declaring that only divine will is at play in everything you think, say, and do. And what the initiation into Christhood is you're going to be manifested into being a relatively unreasonably acting human being who has to, instead of trying to control your choices and control your disposition and control anything about you, you just have to own it as this is divinity at play. And the fear is, if I do that, oh my God, I'm just going to treat people however, and I'm just going to leave people laying in the streets, and I'm just going to be this psychotic God person. And the truth is, you leave people laying in the wake and you become more psychotic when you refuse this initiation. And so we enter the initiation of Christhood by turning our life into a celebration. You get triggered by someone, how do you celebrate? Because you go, I don't want to celebrate. Celebration is embracing any moment with honest enthusiasm. So someone triggers you, hooray, I was just triggered for the 85th time today. Look how amazing I am at being triggered. I am so good at this. Is there some sort of professional league I could enter? Where people could sit in the stadiums just to revel in how cleverly I am triggered into white-hot rage over the most inconsequential things, I think I would be in the starting lineup of that team. So someone in my position who authentically lives their life and these things just don't arise is because they've been celebrated. So I told you about my path where I affirmed everything is the divine. And then because everything is the divine and that divine is the one I am, it just became a celebration of that at full capacity. Thoughts would arise. Awesome. My mind is amazing. And what I found is the ability to compliment yourself increases your self-worth. And when your self-worth increases by you cheering on the masterful talents of things that infuriate you, you create a vibration in your field that makes anything less than divine perfection impossible to arise. So I'd sit there, talk to someone. Oh, look at these thoughts. Wow, they're really upsetting me. Wow, I'm envisioning some pretty dastardly things right here. Wow, it's making me want to laugh at the thought of it occurring. Wow, I'm really good at this. Sometimes I'd even sing a song about it to myself. I'd sing a little song, right? I'm smiling at this person that I really hate because I'm passive aggressive. Actually, my favorite part of the song is when I add it on, because I'm passive aggressive. It's the opposite. What if you made up songs about what you were experiencing? Right? I'm at the grocery store, standing behind this person. They're wearing too much perfume. And I kind of hate them. When will they die? When will they die?
Well, they're writing a check.
That's right. While they're writing a check. When we all have ATM cards. Why are you writing a check? That you have to put through the slide? That takes 2 more seconds? Writing a check? Who writes checks anymore? Use your ATM card. What's wrong with you? Or someone's using their ATM card. Oh, I forgot my PIN. Why did you forget your PIN? Only you know your PIN. Why'd you forget it? Why'd you forget your PIN? I didn't forget my PIN. Why don't you celebrate this stuff? It makes it more fun. I mean, do you see how what happens to the energy when I say this? Hilarious. I'll tell you a funny story about celebration. Because it's the thing is, you could be in this weird level of consciousness where you think your spiritual vibration or your divinity is based on your behavior. The truth is, it's not based on your behavior. It's based on your willingness or unwillingness to celebrate behavior. Does that make sense? So it's not like we sit around and you look at your behavior and you go, oh, I'm clearly not enlightened anymore. I was a second ago, but then I did this, and I gotta go home and give myself a talking to. Right? Right? Just walk myself home. Wait till your heavenly father gets home. It's not what this is about at all. So I'll tell you the funny story about embracing the human condition, because when everything is going to be celebrated with a yay or a yahoo, and when you're celebrating what you judge to be your worst characteristics, and you just do it on the inside that you don't want anyone else to find out about, you ruin the experience for it being what feeds your ego, because your ego can only be fed by something in a state of guilt and shame. So all the things that we're really unproud that we do, oh my God, I had some ice cream, but I didn't put it in a bowl. My bowl was the whole carton. And I didn't even use like a spoon. I used like a turkey ladle and just shoved it in there. Just I didn't even eat it. I shoved. I crammed. Right? That's all. Your ego's only drawn to that if you're doing it in a state of shame and guilt. If you celebrate and honor it with complete ridiculous embellishment and honesty, you ruin it for the ego. And again, underneath the ego is an inner child. So we're not trying to do it maliciously, but we're ruining the things that we're attracted to doing so that we have proof that we're less than the divine. That's why we sabotage ourselves. We act in ways, or we think, I'm going to do this self-destructive thing as a reward from the shitty things I say to myself. I'm going to take like a 5-minute break from being my biggest bully in existence and just shove ice cream in my face. And then when I'm done doing that, I'm going to beat the holy crap out of myself for doing that as if that's some form of repentance. Instead of, if you actually are going to do something self-destructive and you said, this is the will of the divine, and just did it with absolute honesty and enthusiasm, you'd ruin it for the ego and you would rarely do it again. Oh my God, ice cream. Yes, we don't need a bowl. Let's just eat the whole carton. Yes, bring it to the couch, right? We don't sit at the table, the couch. Get my turkey ladle. This is so good. Read the label. Ooh, my God, this is delicious ice cream. Must be that guar gum. Yum, yum, yum. This is so good. What is this? What's the ingredient? Locust bean? That sounds nice. Yum, put that in my face. And if you see, because here's the thing. We create attachments to compulsive behavior like addictions. Do you want to know why? You're only semi-compulsively addicted to things that you're not actually committing to. If you fully committed to the activity, you would bring consciousness to it and it would ruin it for you. Because you're only getting some form of satisfaction on a weird level because you think no one's seeing you. But if you bring consciousness, the consciousness in you is awake in everyone, so it feels like the whole world's there now. Oh my God, everyone's seeing me. Yeah, you're there, being totally conscious of this. And so if there's self-defeating behavior, bring enthusiasm to it completely. I was with a friend once, and this is all funny because this is all true stories. A friend of mine many years ago, and I was with them, and they lit up a cigarette. And they go, and they said, oh, I'm sorry, I shouldn't be smoking. And I said, you know, I find that really infuriating. I said, what do you mean? I said, here you are smoking a cigarette and you don't even have the audacity and level of commitment to fully commit to the activity. They said, I'm going to go over there and smoke. I said, no, you smoke right in front of me. I said, and I want you to puff that thing like it's the most delicious thing you've ever tasted in your life. You've made the choice. Enjoy it. They start getting freaked out. Like, maybe I don't want to smoke. I said, hey, when I enjoy things full on. You want to smoke in front of me? You smoke in front of me. Look me dead in the eye with every breath. You know what? Blow it in my face if you want. Just enjoy it. And they couldn't do it. It was awesome. If you bring that to everything you do, you will very soon find all self-destructive behaviors disappearing out of your field. Because eventually you'll realize I'm not really enjoying this. I'm only doing it because I, as a way of celebrating how less than the divine I am, and I'm just doing this to take a break from my own shame and self-pity. You bring celebration to an activity, not supported by that vibration. There's a level of intelligence to this that is so crafty, it's amazing. Because otherwise, we're like walking around like these spiritual robots, like watching ourselves, like trying to be in our ears, telling ourselves what to do. Okay, Matt, so just shoulders back, better posture, right? You're an awake being now. You need to walk with your shoulders. Oh, yeah, thank you. Okay. Is that what this is about? No, this is about celebrating ridiculousness with full commitment, and then eventually ridiculousness stops arising. I'll give you a perfect example. Many years ago, at Whole Foods Market, again, there a lot, at the hot bar, standing behind someone, you know, I'm ready to get the chicken tikka masala. They just brought out a fresh tray. You ever been somewhere where they bring out a fresh tray and you're like, ooh, it's like gold. Because it's not laying out all day. It's not, you know, the texture might be all, this is fresh. Oh. Right? And that funny thing in your mind is you look at the full tray and you look at the, there's enough for me. As if I'm going to need a whole tray of chicken tikka masala. Oh, there will be no shortage. And in front of me is this person moving quite slowly, and I'm just standing behind them with my beautiful green Whole Foods bowl, breathing slowly. Yes, yes, I will enjoy this breath and moment while you have the first crack at the chicken tikka masala. And I'm waiting, and I'm waiting. I start to look like, I'm standing right behind them, and this has been, you know, usually when you're standing behind someone, they look and they go, oh yeah, I should go, yeah, you should go really fast and get the hell out of my way because I'm ready to eat. And you need to do this really fast and move it along and we're gonna be fine. And this person, not only was it very slow, and then I start to like inspect over their shoulder, right? They don't even know, I'm just like looking, like what are they doing? And what they're doing is they're like fishing for the best pieces. And the reason I know that is because that's what I do. And if they're fishing for the best pieces, that means I don't have anything to fish for. And now, my chicken tikka masala fantasy has become a nightmare. What am I to do? Am I going to sit there and say to myself, oh, you obviously have an attachment to chicken tikka masala. This is obviously one of the last things to be brought up by the world before your supreme enlightenment. Bow to your teacher in front of you, for they are the Zen master. No, this is about commitment. And this is about you're aware of things arising within you, because we're all human beings, even though we're all divine beings having this human play. And we have the awareness of, what are we going to do in our beautiful play? And I'm sitting there, and they're fishing, and they're getting really good pieces. So I'm both admiring their craftsmanship and starting to, and I'm like, I've been standing for like 3 minutes. I took a couple steps forward. I'm like this far from their head, like clearly they're going to feel me. And then they're going to turn around and go, oh, I'm so sorry. No. No. Oh, my God. Oh, that's okay. And so then let's just fully commit to this. And I say, because for me, humor is always the best strategy. And I say, you must be catering an event. I thought, that's a nice way to interject myself into this experience. You must be catering an event. And they go, what? Oh, me? Yeah. Oh, no. Oh, I'm so sorry. You're waiting, aren't you? Oh, waiting. So relative. So, because we don't, right? We don't want other people to feel bad. So we deny what has been stewing inside of us. Oh, relative. Waiting. And they moved along. And then I went to my fishing. But see, that's divine perfection when we commit to it. And if you totally commit to it, recognizing that this is divinity at play, that when you fully commit to things, that's what unravels the judgment out of it. That's what tells it you have nothing more to teach me, and that's what obliterates it out of your field. So that you can be this living anchor of consciousness and start to live in a world where no matter what people do in private, when they're in your presence, they're only reflecting back the vibration that you bring forth. So being a clear awake being that knows how to give people advice and every spiritual slogan you've learned isn't going to matter when you're a bright light living in a world that's just kicking the crap out of you every day, stealing your chicken tikka masala, doing all sorts of ruthless things, right? Jesus, universe, right? I'll face any thought. I'll face any dimension. Don't take my chicken tikka masala. But when you Hooray, everything. Yay, another negative thought. Yeah. Awesome. That one was really good. Good one, God. Oh my God, I'm feeling lonely. Oh, how I am so lonely right now. I am catastrophically lonely right now. Oh my God. Yep, and here I go, looking at people around me. Are they my soulmate? Are they gonna take me from loneliness? Look what I'm doing. Trying to get someone to take my loneliness away and then blame me when they can't. Look at my handiwork. Look at what an amazing creature I am. Yay for me. When you cheer everything that arises, as if it's supposed to be this way because it is, and it is the highest destiny of the divine. Again, not to judge how is this experience the will of the divine, but it is the will of the divine for you to transmute all the beliefs in something other than God existing by celebrating it as a manifestation of the divine. That's when spirituality starts to make sense and stops being ridiculous. When people stop telling you what to do, you just gotta do this. Yes. I mean, and there's nothing wrong with the beautiful teachings of being fully present, letting it go. All these different things have their time and place. But letting it go doesn't help you celebrate. In fact, you don't let it go, it lets go of you, and it lets go of you when your celebration ramps up into ridiculous proportion. It says, all right, I got nothing more to teach them. I'm gonna get the hell out of here. I can't take this celebration anymore. Every time I show up as the scary whatever, it just throws me a party. I can't take that. I'm trying to be the scariest ghouly demon in existence, and they just throw a party for me. It's embarrassing. I'm supposed to be scary. And when the universe fails to shake you out of the realization that no matter what you feel, think, no matter how you act or behave, it is God's will this is happening, and not the justification, well, this is the divine's will, so I'm gonna go be insane and do this forever. But to bring this unreasonable celebration to your activity, you'll no longer resonate with it. When you accept everything as the divine and bring forth a celebration of yay to everything you do, you will cultivate a vibration of celebration that causes over a period of time only the highest thoughts, feelings, inspirations, actions, and behaviors to manifest through you without you being in charge of it. So there are spiritual beings that are trying to be on their best behavior and beating the crap out of themselves when they don't get it right, or there are beings that celebrate how absolutely ridiculous they act until perfection shines through. Which one do you want? One doesn't work and one is amazingly fun. One is the door to salvation and one is a highway to hell. You choose. Yay, I'm sad. Yay, I'm lonely. Yay, I'm insecure. Yay, I'm confused. Yay. Maybe I should seek some wisdom. Why, and interrupt this confusion party? Hell no. No, we're gonna stay confused. And someone's gonna ask you for directions. Hey, how do I get up there? Pfft, I don't know, I'm confused. I don't know what the hell's going on, apparently. I'm the last person you should ask, but good luck to you. Someone calls you up, hey, can you help me move? You know, no, I can't. Why? Well, because I'm lazy and entitled. That's why. And selfish. By God, the Lord has made me selfish. I haven't been able to cure my selfishness. Maybe I thought I'd just accept and fully commit to it and see what happens. So as of today, I'd love to know that I've transmuted the selfishness to be able to help you, but it isn't the case. I can help you, but I refuse to because, on account of my entitlement, you see. on account of my selfishness, I am completely unable to help you at this time. You laugh because that's where life becomes fun. And it helps you get, really quickly you get over this belief of other people's reactions to me are showing me where I'm at in my spiritual journey. No, they don't. Other people's reactions don't show you where you are. Other people's reactions show them where they are. The only thing that shows you where you are is how honest you are about your experience and how deeply you celebrate it. Or I've said before, no specific thought or emotion anchors a lower vibration. The lower vibration is anchored by your refusal to celebrate it as the divine. So you could have the most sinister form of darkness arise in you and you go, yeah. Repressed excitement looking like darkness. Come on, Lord. Show me what you got. What do you got, claws and fangs? Awesome. Best fangs ever. When you bring that to life, nothing touches you. Because you've seen too deeply, you've admitted too deeply, you've gone to celebration town. When you're in celebration town, that's Christhood. And it's not like you're pretending everything's a party. You're willing just to be honest about, I am only attracting and experiencing the very things that give me evidence that there's something other than the divine in existence. And I just celebrate it as the divine to transmute these judgments out of my field, so I'm no longer living as this never-ending transmuter of the collective and become an anchor of the light I already am. I mean, how many times do you see it in a spiritual circle? People hear the teachings, they try to apply it in their life, and they go, here's the thing I must be doing wrong because I can't change this. You can't change anything in your reality. You can only change your ability to celebrate it. And people say, well, I'm not going to celebrate until it feels better. That's not the game. Well, I'm not going to celebrate until it looks different. That's not the game. The game is celebrate with embellished honesty. Admit what is totally true about your worst qualities and crank up the enthusiasm until you laugh. Even what else is amazing about this? Find little moments throughout the day to celebrate your masterful genius in inconsequential moments. I'll give you an example. You go to open the refrigerator. Most people will just open the refrigerator as a means to an end. No, not you. You are an ingenious manifestation of the divine. And you're going to use that little moment of opening the refrigerator to anchor gratitude, to increase your self-worth, to bring forth higher energy for all. And you open that refrigerator door. Look how strong I am. See how good I did that? See how good I did that? I just opened the door with one reach. And most people would go, that's not a celebration. And to them, they're not living a life of anchoring higher vibrations. They're not playing the spiritual game yet. You walk into another room. See how I did that? See, I did that like left, right, like without stopping. Some babies on hands and knees. Not this guy. On my legs, didn't fall once, smooth. And honor the most ridiculous things that you've never been taught are successes. You park your car, parallel park it. See, I did that. One shot. Didn't even hit the curb. Or let's say you do hit the curb. You see that? That's the way it's supposed to be done. It's not supposed to be one smooth little thing. It's supposed to be like a 7-point turn. That's right. You see that? You see that? That homeless guy asked me for a dollar and I said no, but I kind of like stuttered and my lip curled because I'm not comfortable with my body. You see that? See that? That was awesome. That's how you're supposed to do it. You're supposed to say no, but then feel really bad and act weird to give them the satisfaction of knowing, sorry, I'm weird. I can't give you a dollar, but I'm paying the price anyway. clearly mixed up over here. Why not take everything you already do and just make it into something worth celebrating? And you all laugh because it's your soul through laughter and joy opening up to the divinity that's already here. See, it's one thing if the divine wasn't within you and you're trying to act appropriately to kind of create it into existence. But the divine is already here, and the reason it doesn't seem to be visible to you is because you're not accepting everything as already the divine. And when you don't accept everything as already the divine, you're only attracting the evidence that furthers your belief that something other than divine exists. If you just celebrate everything as the divine and just honor yourself as the best in every moment at what you do, because that's not arrogance. Arrogance is when you're better than other people. Confidence is when you're just celebrating the uniqueness of yourself. It's not arrogance until you are, I'm great and they aren't. That's arrogance. Arrogance is a comparison. And the one thing that we all are looking for on the spiritual path is confidence. And it's the one thing that we are sometimes, especially spiritual people, the most afraid of. And if there's someone with confidence, people can project all sorts of stuff that's unnecessary. I've experienced that. I bring a healthy dose of confidence. People go, I don't know about this. I don't know about this teacher. He doesn't sit around hating himself. I can't trust it. There are beings that have experienced self-realization, and then in the aftermath of self-realization, they're left with this feeling of defeat. Do you want to know why? Because they found self-realization, and they're left feeling like that actually wasn't what I was looking for. You'll be guaranteed self-realization, but it's not what you're looking for. And when you're looking for self-realization, you're looking in the wrong direction. What you're looking for is the confidence to accept everything as divinity, whether you understand it or not, and to celebrate yourself in all of your imperfect perfection. If you put on your shoes and socks in the morning, hopefully in the opposite order, right? Socks, then shoes. And don't sit there and go, look at what I just did. Look how good I am the champion. You're missing it. Don't miss out. You wash your dishes? Magnificent. The Lord is washing dishes right now. The Lord is washing the Lord. Making my dishes all lordy. Cleaning the Lord off of the Lord so it can be more lordy. Then I put them all in the Lord machine so they can dry. When you celebrate, life stops devastating you. And I'm only telling you not just what I know, I'm telling you my path with celebration. And I did all of this internally. No one knew I was celebrating. And then eventually I couldn't keep my celebration to myself. And you know, one of the funny things is I celebrated and I still celebrate everything in existence. When I'm not doing what I do, my life is a celebration of ridiculousness. I celebrate everything. And you want to know the most ironic thing about celebrating? There has never been a moment in my life where I have celebrated anything the way I do, and anyone has ever felt bad in my presence or felt polarized by me. Because there's no belief that there's anything else than the divine, so the divine within them starts to entrain with my celebration versus feel separate from it by comparison. So I am bringing forward a celebration so that all can drink from this stream of infinity, so that all can taste the nectar of liberation. And I don't have to stand around outside of work and talk about spirituality. I just celebrate the incredible nature of how amazing life is. Whether anyone thinks they're doing something right or wrong, I am their cheerleader. always and forever. It's one thing to wake up to your true nature. It's another thing to wake up to your true nature, know and become one with the light of divinity, and for your faith and admiration of the divine to increase and intensify. In enlightenment, nothing but God exists. And it doesn't require anyone to act any differently. And there's no justification. I don't justify how beautiful you are. I don't justify how innocent you are. I don't justify how intelligent you are. I don't justify how resilient you are. I just serve you as the divinity that you are, that I am, and invite you into a celebration that all of existence is attending. So welcome to the party. Whatever it is you want to be different in your life, celebrate the crap out of it with honesty. Yep, that's what I do. Yay! If you take the time to celebrate anything that you have a problem with, you'll change the energy. The energy will no longer support that behavior. It will have nothing more to teach you because there's no more judgment. And it will dissolve out of consciousness. And as it dissolves out of your consciousness, it will start to ripple out and dissolve out of the totality of consciousness. So your willingness to celebrate will liberate all. And the excitement you feel in your body when I speak to you this way is because you know what I'm talking about. You just haven't been given permission to celebrate louder than the agony of the collective. And I'm here to give you that permission. You hear shrieks and screams of agony, you celebrate louder so that those who are in pain can be freed on your behalf. We're not denying people's pain. We're not certainly not laughing at people's pain. We're liberating them from pain by cranking up the celebration in our own lives so that something different can arise within them. That is service. A service called celebration.